All right, the next one here, you know, is as a kid, I thought it'd be nothing cooler than working for National Geographic, going all around the world, taking pictures and writing articles about different countries, right? So I figured I better, you know, this is in fourth grade now, I better show them what I got with my report about Norway here. So I got out the scissors and glue, and I made perhaps the finest country report ever produced in a fourth grade classroom. And alas, it didn't quite have the circulation that a National Geographic did, but boy, howdy did I dedicate myself to this report. And I'd say, well, it wasn't very risky, but I did definitely improve my craft by learning about the importance of citations, all the illustrations, all that kind of stuff. So I'd probably plot that one, well, probably somewhere around here. Now, as I got a little bit older and ended up as a high school dropout at a community college, I got this great job because I thought, what would be a better job than working at a library? So I got the job where I worked from 3 o'clock to 11 o'clock as a night librarian at this community college. And it was great. I was surrounded by books and all these interesting people coming in and out. And I learned how to use the Xerox copier. Because, and I'd made these fanzines in the past, but I was in this class that was the first ever honors creative writing class at this community college. Granted, this is in Utah, right? And so we got together on a late night renegade mission and produced a little book of all our writings. And I had included some short fiction in here, a little story about being stopped at the border in Sweetgrass, Montana. And I included this because my teacher in that class had said, you know, Dave, your creative writing is great, but your expository writing, your essays aren't all that good. I'm like, what? I was shocked. So I was determined to become the best expository essay writer I could possibly be. And oddly enough, the opportunity came a few years later after a few projects writing about the Glen Canyon Dam and some different interests I had about environmental activism. I was in Japan and I learned all about the history of hemp culture in Japan. And believe it or not, you know, I took all my notes and I said, you know, who wants to publish these? And up steps the Journal of the International Hemp Association. This is an academic association with a bunch of PhDs about hemp research. Believe it, it exists. No snickering. I hear you in the back row. And so they worked with me over the course of months to take all my notes and my drafts that I thought I had great rhythm and pacing and sentence structure, the things that I value as a writer. And they said, well, we need a citation for this. And it's like, so I learned all about how to cite a reference for a guy that you met at a, you know, in a field harvesting rice. Someone else you had a conversation with at a art school, and so on. And it turned into this beautiful work that then I could, because I was presenting this information for the first time in the English language, that I could stand behind and not feel like, well, maybe there's a real story. Maybe there's an expert out there that knows more than me about this. That was great because then once it was published in here, all the other, lots of other magazines wanted to pick it up, and I would have a hard time feeling comfortable with it going into cannabis culture if it hadn't been thoroughly vetted and referenced and organized and suit and tied by the academics over here at the Journal of International Hemp Association. And what it taught me is that by telling the same story, you can tell it in a bunch of different ways geared for different audiences, right? So the same research about hemp in Japan has appeared in academic journals, in cannabis culture is the best of issue for that. Also here in this Heads magazine and all these different contexts where the same thing can exist. So the story can take on other mediums, and even the design. This is just some simple black and whites. These have big, full, glossy photo layouts and breakout boxes and so on, but it's just all about being a servant of the story that you want to tell. Okay, I'll show you a couple more here really quick before, because I know you got a bus to catch, but now one I really wanted to show you, but I couldn't find the picture of it that rated really high on my taking risks, was dressing up as King Tut in a fifth grade science fair project in Wally. Now bear in mind that this costume involved a loincloth, kind of a gold pendant, and a giant helmet. And I decided that would be a good idea because I really wanted to win the science fair, to go there in costume, we're there with my scale model, because I thought at the time, what could be better than being an archaeologist, right? And I wanted to show them what I could do. I could help out with that excavating and that research and that analysis. So I made a scale model of King Tut's tomb. So I'd say I honed some craft on that one, because I was working with that dough stuff and mixing that up and building this whole structure and then painting little ornaments. And also, because I was showing up to school in a loincloth, definitely high risk there. I do have my elementary school report cards to prove this, but I'll spare you that. Now, another project, and this is one that I've mentioned a few times, and one of the projects I'm most proud of. I'd been traveling around Europe, then in Japan, then in Guam, and I took all these inspirations and I created a series of short form kind of haiku-like poems, but accompanied with brightly colored, but single stroke Japanese style. So I was kind of mushing together Japanese and European influence. And I laid them all out into a little book here, went to a copy center. I ordered up some hemp paper that was shipped over from Oregon to the island of Guam. And I printed these things out. And in here, I still have all the originals and all the original layout of the book and all the original paintings. And to me, I can't believe that I took the time to do this as a younger version of myself. And I'm almost, it seems strange to say that you're grateful for yourself for doing this, but I truly am that I took the time to do this, because now these provide me with a shortcut, a rabbit hole to jump right back into who I was at that stage of my time. So it's easy to then express yourself and remix your own work and do all sorts of other things with it. So that's the part about taking risk and honing craft. For me, this is about just about as high up in the chart as it reaches for me. I'm gonna put that right up there, because I was mixing all sorts of different art. I took everything I had to do this thing. And as it happens, this is, let's just say a lot more people read the Cannabis Culture article than ever read that book there. So finally, one other thing that I would score pretty high on my little self-imposed matrix here is doing this multidisciplinary project of making a feature-length documentary film, including the cover, the soundtrack, the narration, the screenplay, driving around the country, interviewing people. It takes a huge amount of work. But the point of me showing you this isn't just to show that I made that this is a video cassette for you youngsters out there. It's VHS. But I wanted to find my badge to prove to you that I worked at Kinko's for 3 months just so I could use all the computers to design this cover after hours to make this, because I really wanted this thing to be awesome. So I did what it took. So don't ever get hung up on the resources that you have or the resources that you don't have, the tools that you know how to use or the ones that you don't. Take them all and use them all and do whatever you want with them in order to tell your story. It's all about the story. And don't get precious with it. Don't get hung up and think about what are other people going to think. You're writing this for yourself, right? Everyone else is just tagging along for the ride. So I'm going to sit in here and read my journals, but I guess I better get you on to that bus stop down the road. There's nothing better than looking back on a project finished, though, and knowing that you put all yourself into it. You didn't compromise a bit. And celebrate. Well, all those boxes and all those binders in there are all completely filled with source materials. I could have you over here for a week, but I know you got a bus to catch and a conference to listen to, but it really is a treat to have you coming by, and I hope you learned something about that everything you're doing to publish online really comes from the experiences that you've crafted in your life and the stuff that you've squeezed out of your life. And this isn't just me saying. Really, on these shelves here, these are really my treasures. These are my heroes. And each of these books has offered me solace and wisdom on a rainy afternoon. From Kerouac to Tolstoy to Salinger to Richard Brautigan to Henry David Thoreau. And like as Robbie Burns would say, if you have a poet in your back pocket, you'll never be lonely. So the bus stop is just out the door, down to the left to the end of the line. Have a great conference out there, Northern Voice. Hang loose.